It must have happened hundreds, even thousands of times over the past 20 years. A young boy suddenly deeply impacted by the sight of them, somehow singled out to hold that image in his mind as an overwhelming reason for living. One day, I'll do that, he tells himself. There are among such boys a number who never lose sight of the dream. They pursue it doggedly, focusing and fashioning their lives towards its realization. To become a snowbird, a member of Canada's magnificent aerobatic team, is for many a childhood dream come true, the crowning achievement of their lives. On the occasion of the snowbirds' 20th anniversary, this is their story. The story of the snowbirds begins here in Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, a town not generally associated with heroics. A few kilometers south of the town lies Canadian Forces Base Moose Jaw, a training base where all pilots in the Canadian Forces earn their jet wings, where they enter the home stretch towards realizing their dreams. Arriving here, 431 Air Demonstration Squadron, Snowbirds.
Well, good afternoon, gentlemen. Welcome to the 1990 Snowbird Tryouts. It's certainly a great pleasure for us to have you here in Moose Jaw with us. You've been selected to try out for the Snowbirds from among a relatively large number of volunteers across the country. And we've chosen the 8 of you because we think you have the necessary professional and personal attributes that we're looking for in a snowbird pilot. There's no question that the next 2 or 3 weeks is going to be some of the most challenging and hopefully rewarding flying you're going to do in your Air Force careers. But your performance and your success or failure on this team is going to depend largely on your desire. Experience has shown that it's the desire that's going to separate those who make the team from those who don't.
A tour of duty with the Snowbirds lasts 2 years, with half the team changing each year. This year, 8 candidates try for 4 positions. They fly with second-year pilots who judge their performance. They are all experienced pilots. Some are instructors at Moose Jaw. Others come from operational squadrons. In trying out for the Snowbirds, they put their reputations on the line. They know going in their chances are 50-50.
You're over-controlling the power a little.
For the first time, almost unbelieving, they discover what close formation flying really means. Piloting a jet at hundreds of miles an hour, closer to others around you than you would even park a car. For most of them, the tryouts are the toughest 2 weeks of their lives. The team leader and second-year pilots have met and made their selections.
Brooks Lawrence, come on in.
And of course, the last trip was over about 2:30, and then the second-year guys and the boss went back to the room, and they were gone for a good 3 hours, I guess.
It's been a long 2 weeks, eh?
Yes, it is.
Well, I know we've been keeping you in suspense all day, and I apologize for taking so long, but it's obviously a pretty difficult choice. I want to go through your tryouts with you. We thought that you had a bit of trouble adapting to the outside wing, and I'm not sure what it was.
Of course, he'd gone through the debrief, you know, and it wasn't sounding very good at all. All of a sudden, his face changed expression, and he smiled and told me I was on the team. It was the happiest day of my life.
Thank you, sir. You did it. You did very, very well.
They come out of there Snowbirds, members of the team, 3 feet off the ground, phone the wife, mom, and dad, let the world know. And whether they know it or not at the time, a mantle of onerous responsibility settles on their shoulders. Theirs is now the charge of carrying forward Canada's pride in aviation excellence. The tradition of flight in Canada began in 1909 with Alexander Graham Bell, builder of the Silver Dart, successfully flown just a few historical moments after the Wright brothers at Kitty Hawk. Once flight was proven possible, Canadians took to the air like ducks to water, like no other nation on Earth.
It really took the airplane and bush pilots flying airplanes of fabric and wood and wire and opening up areas of the north that really opened up and mapped this country. And I think built a tremendous fondness and appreciation for things of the air. People in the northern parts of this country particularly have a tremendous regard for airmen and airplanes. They're fascinated with them. And I think that it's a part of our cultural heritage. So air shows and the things of the air are always in tremendous demand in this country. I think more so than any other country.
Just 5 years after their formation in 1924, the Royal Canadian Air Force met public expectations with their first aerobatic display team, the Siskins, five biplane aircraft, three of which flew during shows, barnstorming their way across the continent until 1931, when they were disbanded. A number of teams followed, reinforcing the tradition. In 1959, the Golden Hawks were formed to celebrate the 35th anniversary of the RCAF and the 50th of powered flight in Canada.
The Golden Hawks were an absolutely superb team, and I look back on the great fondness. Our maneuvers were very close to the ground, close to the crowd. We made maximum impact on the crowd in terms of speed and noise.
Under pressures of restraint, the Golden Hawks were disbanded in February 1964. For 3 years, the tradition was suspended until in 1967, to celebrate Canada's centennial year, the Golden Centenaires took to the air. Commanding the team, Colonel O.B. Philp.
Commanding the Centenaires was really a key to this whole thing about the Snowbirds coming about. When I got involved with the Centenaires, I knew nothing about aerobatic teams per se. I had organized air shows, I'd been done personal demonstrations, but I had never been involved directly with an aerobatic team. Over that year, 1967, we traveled and did 100 air shows in Canada. I got to meet a lot of the Canadian public, and it was amazing to me that the Canadian public were asking me questions like, why did we cancel the Golden Hawks? Don't let this happen to the Golden Centenaires. We, the Canadian public, wanted an aerobatic team. They felt it was their team. So I had quite an education.
Over OB's protests, the Centenaires were disbanded at year's end. OB was appointed base commander at Moose Jaw in 1969. Canada's forces were undergoing unification at the time, a delicate period during which the last thing on the minds of the senior command was a new aerobatic team. OB had other ideas.
I said, well, let's get a formation demonstration team going, which I could do within my own authority, my own mandate. We were a training command base. The flying instructors here on this base, they needed flying proficiency so they could instruct the students. A lot of this was tongue-in-cheek at the time, but the fact of life remains, it was a method of getting the whole thing started.
He used imagination and creative accounting to make it happen.
I thought it was important, so I went ahead and did it.
The truth of the matter is, OB founded the Snowbirds on the sly and in conspiracy with those who formed the first team.
Well, I remember being quite overawed by it all. You know, it was a great chance, and I had flown F-86s in the Golden Hawk days, and I didn't fly with the Hawks, but I was starting a tryout with them and got offered a 104 starfighter posting and took that instead. But I always had the urge to be involved with an aerobatic team, but I really wanted to be in front rather than at the back following someone. So when he called me in and said, I want you to to take it on. I was more than happy to do it. And besides that, Obi was a very persuasive individual, and you didn't say no to him easily.
They were strictly volunteers, of course. They trained evenings and weekends in their spare time. They were strictly a formation team, of course. No aerobatic maneuvers allowed.
Well, initially, in 71, we didn't have modified aircraft, so you could only fly them from one seat if you were going to fly solo, because the gear levers and things like that were on one side. So we had to carry two pilots in some of the airplanes to fly both, you know, either side of the formation if you're moving around.
They performed 25 shows that first 1971 season. Team members themselves put up funds to cover cost of PR material and distinctive flight suits. By hook, by crook, by the seat of their pants, the Snowbirds were born, and a tradition upheld. Before the bitter moose jaw winter sets in sometime in November, next year's Snowbirds begin 6 months of intense training. As military pilots, they have all faced challenges before, but none like this.
Okay, challenge this afternoon is the winds.
The agenda for each flight, every aspect of it, is discussed beforehand.
Basically out of the northwest all the way up 30 knots. So the name of the game is going to be heads up. We tried the other day for the first time with the seven plane, the 4 feet overlap. We haven't done it yet with the solos. We'll try that today. And it's mainly for Rich being new on the outside. So again, caution.
Each pilot signs acceptance for his aircraft, assuming responsibility for its condition. As they gear up, members of the ground crew look on. Part of the team, proud of the contribution they make.
Okay, everybody here, guys? Yeah. Okay, let's go.
That's enough training.
Over the months of training and show season to come, a remarkable relationship grows between pilot and ground crew, one-on-one. They are paired off, each crewman responsible for the condition of his partner's aircraft. In the intense pursuit of excellence, they become friends. In many ways, it's probably the most demanding tour of duty any of these men could undertake. Demanding and rewarding. They're thrown together in a cauldron of unrelenting effort from which they must emerge in a few short months, a single welded unit, absolute masters of all they do.
Looking back on it, it's kind of like being in a fog. You wonder how you sort of really made it through all that, because you knew so little, really. Boy, if I could know what I knew now then, it would have been a much easier time of it.
They fly two, sometimes three training missions a day. Each lasts 50 minutes or so. A 10-minute warm-up followed by 40 minutes of total concentration on show maneuvers. In that time, they expend more energy than many do in a full day's work.
When we're building a show, we use very much a building block process. But you start off with perhaps four aircraft, with the second-year pilots, flying with the first-year pilots, teaching them how to do the basic formation maneuvers and formation aerobatics. Start off with a simple loop and a roll. From there, as each pilot becomes more comfortable with his new position, the first-year pilots, then you start to let them go solo for certain maneuvers. And it's obviously the big goal that the team always has is to get all nine guys solo. I mean, that's your first real indication that you're going in the right direction. When you get all nine pilots solo for the first time, you go out there and you do a nine-plane loop. That is really an exciting development in your show. We always try and get that done before Christmas if we can, weather permitting.
How many times in a person's life do they have to totally concentrate, at least for 30 straight minutes? And basically, your life depends on it.
The aircraft are trimmed forward to improve control, which means what is called a heavy stick. Just keeping the nose up requires a constant back pressure on the control column.
Then, of course, you progress to the next most difficult maneuver, which is a nine-plane roll, quite a bit more difficult than doing a straight loop. So once you've achieved that sort of thing, then you gradually, and very gradually, over about a 5.5-month period, start to build the different maneuvers into the show.
When I started off flying formation, you would have a very small sight picture. Looking at the Leeds aircraft, you almost get a tunnel vision, whereby you're looking at so intensely at one particular portion of his aircraft, and all the other aircraft around you, although they're there, you don't notice them. You have to fly in that specified box, that specified area, because if you get outside of it, then you're going to start to disrupt the flow of the formation.
To make their job even more interesting, the Tudor aircraft was never designed for formation aerobatics in the first place.
These airplanes run out of power way sooner than the other guys do, and so to do some of the maneuvers, they haven't got the acceleration to make the thing happen or to give them the extra performance, and so they have to make up with skill, really, what they lack in performance in the airplane. And that skill is not only in the wingman's hands, it's in the lead's hands too, because he's got to set the whole thing up so that he doesn't run his wingman out of power. And it's such a delicate balance with big formations with an airplane like this. Their five-plane line of rest roll, for example, is technically very, very difficult.
Well, during that line of rest roll, if my roll rate is off at all, or if my slowdown in the roll doesn't come at the right time, I'm either going to cause number six on the extreme right-hand side to fall out of position, or usually number seven, give him a hard time, because when the roll starts, six is at full power, seven's got his speed brakes out and his power back to stay with the roll. And halfway around that roll, number seven's got to put his speed brakes in and go full power at exactly the right instant, or he's going to stretch on that maneuver.
And nobody in North America has even tried to do that, the other military teams. But for them, it's a standard maneuver. You know, I mean, it's been in their package for many, many years.
Okay, the rollback portion is going pretty well. Right now, Brooke, I think you're just staying comfortably wide.
That's right, yeah.
Okay. The big thing for the Philly and roll, I think, is when you do get moved back into where you want to be here, is you're going to have to step it up a little bit higher. Take off.
After each flight, every moment of it is analyzed by the pilots.
Part of the problem is that with the cold temperatures, I'm accelerating that much faster, yeah. And I'm just reluctant to really pull the power back any quicker than I am.
Yeah, right.
As G-forces build and blood drains down, pilots must strain to remain conscious. By imperceptible degrees, day by day, maneuver by maneuver, their performance improves. The formation grows tighter, the show comes together. They fly it closer to the ground. Some pilots take longer than others to get used to what they call the ground rush effect.
You can't allow your mind to wander thinking, boy, are we low and are we going fast? You have to look at his aircraft, and you know that he's not going to put you into the ground. You know that. You can't allow fear to come into the cockpit, because it acts like a catalyst. It would increase and increase and increase to the point where you probably couldn't fly an aircraft.
There have been accidents over the years. Three fatalities during shows, but none during training.
Any one of those nine pilots can make a call at any time during the show if he's not comfortable to either move a formation wider or to cancel a maneuver outright.
The Snowbirds actually design the show themselves. Each new team builds on previous experience, and the show they present is different.
You know, depending who the nine pilots are and the remainder of the team, they have a character all themselves, and they design that show around the people that are there. The other teams around in North America don't have that flexibility as much, and they're given their routines from above and told to do things in certain ways. Where we're able to, once we prove to the generals that it's safe what we're doing, we're able to change it just about any way we want.
How do we improve that visual impact that we're trying to give the spectators who are watching the show? And that can be done in a lot of different ways. It can be done by changing a maneuver, modifying a maneuver that already exists in the show. It can be done by introducing a brand new maneuver. And over the years, the team has demonstrated that the pilots on the team have tremendous imagination when it comes to designing new maneuvers.
The solo job is very unique and obviously quite exciting. We need to be good in both formation and low-level aerobatics, but we need to be the expert in the latter as we push the aircraft to its limits.
They'll start off relatively high above the ground, flying together in one aircraft, because the new opposing solo must learn to mirror the performance of the lead solo in the opposite aircraft. Until that comfort level builds up for the new solo, whereby they can allow themselves to get a little bit closer, slowly move down in altitude, and then again, that magic day when they first come together and do a level roll against each other for the very first time.
In 20 years, the Snowbirds have performed 1,060 shows throughout North America, in aircraft now over 25 years old. Not once was a show canceled because an aircraft malfunctioned.
The pilots will fly 2 to 3 shows every day. And for each flying hours that the aircraft is, the ground crew has to work on the airplane for approximately 2.1 hours. So if you do that 3 times a day, you'll have to work on the airplane at least 6 hours. That's not counting the inspection, the daily inspections, the before flight inspection, after flight inspection, the refueling, the dieseling. So it makes for a very long hours. In the winter, the guys will work 12, 14 hours a day for as long as they're flying. Each technician is assigned one airplane, and he will take care of that airplane as far as fuel, diesel, and daily and inspections that has to be done on that airplane. Also, he will take care of all the aircraft in his field of specialty. And we're very proud of that fact that 10 guys can take care of 11 airplanes on the road for 6 months. The pilot-ground crew relation is really exceptional. You will fly with that pilot for 6 months straight. You get very close to this man.
While pilots and ground crew are quite literally getting their act together, arrangements for performing it, when and where, are made by the team's office staff.
Great. Do you know where the crowd line is going to be and the Snowbird aircraft parking?
From hundreds of requests received, 74 shows are scheduled at places ranging from the Yukon to Texas, Newfoundland to California.
One of the things that we have always prided ourselves in the Snowbirds is that it does not matter whether we're performing before 1 million people or whether we're performing before a very small community of perhaps 200 people in the Canadian North. I think it's very important for this team because we have the ability to reach out to all Canadians across the country to try and do that as much as possible.
The grueling months of training are nearly over. Months during which these men left home early and arrived back late, totally exhausted almost every day. Family Day has become a tradition, a chance for loved ones to feel part of it all, to share the sense of pride and accomplishment team members feel. Soon now, the show season will begin, May through October. Millions across the continent will marvel at the Snowbirds, but their families will see them hardly at all. After storing their personal luggage, all the spare parts they can carry, just as they will on the road, the Snowbirds leave Moose Jaw for Comox on Vancouver Island. The only major aerobatic team in the world without support aircraft. Final workouts are essentially show performances, start to finish, perfecting every maneuver, every split-second moment, until it sparkles. Important. Away from home base, the men come together as a team like never before. This year, for the first time, colored smoke is used. 2 new maneuvers are introduced. The maple leaf burst, and the spectacular Filion roar. Comox, the Snowbirds hit the road. 21 people in 11 little jets. Suddenly, the Snowbirds are like any performers on the road, enjoying the fruits and the motel burdens of showbiz. While they may not consider themselves as such, they are celebrities, heroes in the eyes of those they meet. Sowers of the seeds of childhood dreams. Like all performers, they have a single overriding purpose: to satisfy an audience. Unlike most, they perform on a stage 16 kilometers across, 1 kilometer high, at speeds over 500 kilometers an hour. 9 aircraft in less space than a 747. Their audience this year will number over 3.5 million spellbound people, for a total of 65 million plus since 1971. Back then, when the Snowbirds were first formed, few people believed they would survive.
I had a strong belief that it would last, and the reason I had that was because in our 72 tours, and we hit a lot of smaller towns, and we could go into a small town as they can now, and the population of the town would be 5,000, and we'd get 15 or 20,000 people there. And the people would say, God, that's the biggest crowd we've ever seen here. I've lived here 50 years and I've never seen that many people around.
Survive the Snowbirds did, and for a very good reason. The show they deliver does more than thrill the millions who watch. It provides an indelible demonstration of the quest for excellence on the part of Canada's armed forces.
They're one of the showcase groups that we have, and they also serve for those of us in the forces as role models for a lot of our young people, of course, but also as a source of pride and inspiration, not only to people in the Air Force, but to all military people who have a chance to watch them perform.
In a powerful but subtle way, they are also messengers meant to convey a sense of what the forces do for their country and how well they do it day in and day out, largely without fanfare or recognition. As a public relations and recruiting vehicle, the Snowbirds are nothing short of superb.
The Snowbirds realize that they're flying for the crowd. They're accessible. People who run air shows love to have them at their show because they're cooperative. They love to go out and amongst the folks and before and after the show. It's an accessible, viewable, in front of you all the time air show. That's professional to the nth degree.
You can anticipate less.
Before each show, a pre-flight briefing.
Here, I'm going to delay a little bit because of the wind. Okay. Then I'll turn it down in, and I'll probably pull up the Concorde if it's good 15 to 20 knot wind. I'll pull the Concorde right at stage center because we'll be drifting quite a bit. And again, because the wind may have to roll it out and drive it in a little bit before we reverse it. Concorde topside's been going well for us. Okay. No problem there. Solos will be coming in from dead side for the rejoin.
Our mandate is public relations and recruiting. We have become, in every sense of the word, ambassadors for this country. So I think that we can never fail to forget why we're here. For the Snowbirds of the future, the air show is something that obviously gets the people interested in the team. But the work we do at the fence after the show, the hospital visits, the school visits with the kids, are a big part of our job.
Watching these men as they prepare for takeoff, watching what audiences rarely see, incidentally, one wonders what it feels like in there, alone in the cockpit. Following procedures for the umpteenth time, aware of the thousands waiting.
It's claustrophobic. The seat is frightfully uncomfortable. It's rather violent at times. The whole strapped in, bound in, mask on the face thing is a little different.
A little different. What a way to go to work. Usually, it's a good show for the pilots. Other times, not as satisfying. But for the audience who never see the imperfections the small errors performers make, it's 26 minutes of sheer spectacle, and they love it. The Snowbirds always make themselves available afterwards, answer questions, sign autographs. They stay as long as it takes, often hours.
The Snowbirds exemplify the traditions of the forces, the excellence of the forces, the dedication, the spirit of self-sacrifice, not only for the people who are part of the team, but for their families, who are often overlooked in this equation. And I see that role continuing as we embark on this road to implementing policy down to the 21st century.
Yeah, and I don't know, I wouldn't know how you put your finger on it. I think some of it's probably typically Canadian. You know, we don't run around thinking we are the best. And even if we are the best, we are not the first to tell you that, you know. And that's a little different about Canadians, and it's certainly the way these guys are.
I think it's the nine airplanes that you have in the show, and the fact that you're no more than 8 seconds to center stage instead of the hurry up by and wait for them to come back the other way. It's something going on all the time. It's an action-packed, really a well-planned and choreographed show.
We're going to be coming in from Quebec here.
Outside performances and working the crowds, The Snowbirds schedule all kinds of community appearances, constantly adjusting plans to meet the many requests they get. Children in hospital always get priority. Who knows the healing effects of childhood dreams?
Well, these guys are special guys. And we deal with the organizers of all the major shows over and over and over again, year after year after year. And all of them, without question, just think the world of the Snowbirds. These guys are probably sought after more than any team in North America, without question. And every one of them comments on not only the quality of the act, but on the quality of the guys flying the airplanes. It's they're down-to-earth guys. They're just normal guys, you know. They don't think they're anything special, and the Americans just love that.
Most airshow promoters would kill to get the Snowbird team to their airshow. I know I'm one of them.
They are accessible, and they're usually very nice young men, which is, I think, a reflection of the Canadian character. Kind of self-effacing, humorous, nice young men.
Number one in the world. I think they're the absolute best that's on the line anywhere.
You know, and it makes you proud to be a Canadian, I can tell you.
Sometimes it's overwhelming, like this year in Ottawa, during the Canada Day festivities where we went on stage with David Foster. The reception we got was simply overwhelming, and it's hard to describe the feeling you get. You get a lot of pride on it, and that helps you to do even more.
The Snowbirds fly in formation with a Lancaster bomber, a veteran of World War II, now fully restored, in tribute to the pilots who flew many like it in the RCAF 431 Squadron. On April 1st, 1978, the Snowbirds were accorded permanent status in the Canadian Air Force as 431 Air Demonstration Squadron. They continue a proud tradition. Coming up, join the Snowbirds on the... The end of this Snowbird story begins here, where the story started. Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, an improbable place to find heroes. It is mid-October, end of the Snowbirds' 20th season. At the base just outside town at 431 Squadron, a tremendous number of heroes are assembling, meeting and greeting. They come from retirement, from other bases, from across Canada, from around the world. They are the Snowbird alumni, members of all the teams since 1971. They come to celebrate the Snowbird's 20th anniversary. Number 7 hangar at the base, the 11 little jets have been moved out and hundreds moved in for a beer call. A chance to meet, to socialize. One by one, the teams of the years get together for commemorative photographs. Many are wearing flight suits which no longer fit. The surroundings are Spartan, decidedly military. But the emotions here, the memories of what they did together, are anything but. At formal dinner, their mentor, their imaginative founder, their hero, Colonel O.B. Filt, now retired, is asked to address the assembly.
Since we had the resources anyway, I decided within my own mandate to start with a formation demonstration team. No aerobatics, except those which the team practiced illegally when they were out of sight down in the practice area. And Glenn Young, husband, I always knew. And all this done under the premise that if these instructors were going to teach formation flying to the students, they themselves needed to formation practice to maintain efficiency, with tongue in cheek.
For members of the 20th anniversary Snowbird team, it is the lull before the daunting storm of challenge tomorrow, flying the final show of the season before these, their predecessors and peers, the ultimate audience. There is no public at this performance, no crowd to merely please. Their families are watching, military brass, and scores of snowbirds, the most critical and most supportive spectators of all.
Up. Snowbirds, split now.
It is a show of shows, with tears in Obie's eyes, the crowning achievement of a crowning year. Nobody except the team witnesses the true finale. They will remember these moments, this year, these friends, the rest of their lives, and relive it all many times. Later that day, an event of significance. All are assembled to participate. There is pomp and formality. The 20th anniversary Snowbird team marches out on parade, ready for inspection by the commander of Canada's Air Command. The reason for this military ceremony? Major Dan Dempsey, team lead for the past 2 years, will hand over command of the Snowbirds to an old friend, Major Bob Steffen, team lead for the 2 years to come.
It's probably been the most rewarding job I'll ever have in my life, to have control of a group like the Snowbirds, whose goal is ultimately the pursuit of excellence both in the air and on the ground, is a real honor. And it's something that that I'll certainly never forget. I really appreciated the opportunity to fly with this team. It's really the final chapter, I guess, in a childhood dream for me.
The feeling, honestly, is indescribable. There's a little bit of nervousness because you have so much to live up to, but it feels awfully good as well.
In ceremony and succession, the tradition of the Snowbirds endures. It will happen hundreds, even thousands of times in years to come. Young boys suddenly, deeply impacted by the sight of them, somehow singled out to hold that image in their minds as an overwhelming reason for living.
Right there and then, I decided one day I'd do that. I'd be a snowboarder.
Childhood dreams do come true.